For many of the developing countries, it was a time of crisis. And the sources of crises were many, but one of the most relevant elements was the lack of fiscal sustainability. By the early 2000s, only 4 countries had domestic default, and 70 countries have sovereign external debt in default or restructuring. So we moved from 12 countries to only 4, and from 33 to 17 countries. So we, the countries which are in this, I don't know how you call it, it's kind of dark red, are the countries that have more than 75% of our GDP of debt. So you will see countries like the US and Canada, you will see clearly Japan, but you will see also Pakistan on that run, right? How do you actually do this in practice? How do you have discipline in a government?
Why do these countries borrow so much?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Welcome to PIDE World Bank public lecture on sustainable fiscal reforms, international experience and applications for Pakistan. We are pleased to welcome Arturo Herrera, who is the Global Director for Governance, Global Practice in the Equitable Growth, Finance and Institution Practice Group at the World Bank. As Global Director for Governance, Mr. Herrera priorities include leading the formulation of strategy and engagement of the bank's work on public institutions and country-level governance, especially in fragile, conflict, and violent settings, maximizing the effectiveness of operational support for public finance management and public procurement, fostering excellence in governance practice work on public sector administration and operational support for legal and judicial reform. With this, I would like to invite Arturo to make his presentation, followed by Dr. Nadeem. He will make his response, and then we'll have the question answer. Please.
Really happy to be here. I must advise you that I arrive at 4 a.m. in the morning. So if there's something inconsistent in my presentation, you could always blame me on my sleep. I'm really happy to be here. As my title said, I have a global responsibility at the World Bank. I lead a group that works on issues related to budget, revenue mobilization, access to justice, anti-corruption practices, transparency. It's a very wide portfolio. And this is my first time in the South Asia region, so really happy to start it here. Actually, it's I'm really glad that I start my first intervention at a university, because actually I decided to start this by telling you how was my country and the economic situation of my country when I was a student, a little bit younger than what you are. So in 1984, when I was a little economist and I started my studying economics, the inflation rate in Mexico was 60.4%. We were in the middle of a crisis. The first devaluation was in 1982. And for the better part of the 80s, there was a debt crisis, an inflation crisis, a lack of performance. It became a little bit better in the mid-90s. And then in 1995, Mexico devalued again. There was the inflation shoot again to 35%. This actually triggered a crisis across Latin America. It was called the tequila crisis. So it started in Mexico and moved to Argentina, Brazil, most of the countries. So when I was studying, for me, studying economy was about prices. It was about how to stop inflation, how to stabilize the government. And that was when I was in college, when I was in master's, and when I was doing my PhD. So there was the only thing that was permanent was crisis. Then in 1997, we have the East Asian financial crisis, which is started as an exchange rate crisis in Thailand, and then moved, spread along along East Asia. So for a long period in the 80s and in the 90s, for many of the developing countries, it was a time of crisis. And the sources of crises were many, but one of the most relevant elements was the lack of fiscal sustainability. So in order to try to achieve fiscal macro stability, fiscal sustainability was a relevant issue. Now, why did I wanted to start in the 1980s? Because in the 1980s, 20 countries had domestic debt defaults. 33 countries had sovereign external debt, either defaults or restructure. And then it seems like after going through all this very difficult period, we learned how to manage these problems. And by the early 2000s, only 4 countries had domestic default, and 70 countries have sovereign external debt in default or restructure. So we moved from 12 countries to only 4, and from 33 to 17 countries. So we thought debt problems were a problem of the past, were an issue of history. Then two things happened. In 2008, 2009, we have the Great Recession, the financial crisis, and that started putting stress in countries. And more recently, COVID, a crisis triggered by a non-economic, non-financial event, started a series of issues because as countries needed to face COVID, three things happened. First, the lockdown reduced economic activity and reduced the revenue. Then governments had to have larger expenses in terms of buying vaccines, reholding hospitals, etc., and that reduced the fiscal space. And then we have inflation in the aftermath of COVID, which increased the interest rates. As a result of that, by 2023, we have 35 countries which are in the debt sustainability framework for low-income countries. And so it seems that the problem of the 80s, the problem of the 90s, the problems that we thought they were solved are coming back. So it's the need to, it's about time to start rethinking again how to regain fiscal sustainability across the globe. Now, this will give you an idea of how do we have the issues associated to gross public debt. The countries which are in this, I don't know how you call it, it's kind of dark red, are the countries that have more than 75% of their GDP of debt. So you will see countries like the US and Canada. You will see clearly Japan, but you will see also Pakistan on that run, right? My own country is in a bracket below, between 50 and 75%. So this is a first approximation to try to understand if the finances of a country are sustainable or not. In theory, a very large debt problem could be associated with a very large debt service, but that's not necessarily the case. Anybody has an idea which is the country with the largest debt over GDP? Huh? Japan, yeah? So is Japan in the verge of a crisis? No? And let me tell you why. You will have here Japan with a debt of 252% of GDP, but only with an interest rate of 0.88%. So that means that Japan pays a little bit more than 2% of GDP on interest rates. Now, if you think a country like, I'm not going to pick up Pakistan, okay? But if you think, for example, Greece, with a debt of 168%, but with an interest rate of 3.55%, it pays much more higher interest rates. So debt over GDP is a very important element, but how sustainable are the fiscal finances? Send a signal to the market along with the macro stability that may allow even countries with very high debt levels to pay relatively little interest rates. So if you think about, my own country, Mexico, it probably pays around 4% of GDP on interest rates, while Japan, which with a debt much higher, pays half of it. So the connection between macro stability, financial stability, and debt over GDP mix in a complicated cocktail. So, but let's assume that there's a country that is over indebted, right? And that this is in the problems. Then what it is required is to try to find out what should be the trajectory to try to stabilize that country. So let me start with very obvious definitions on the left hand side. The deficit is just expenditures minus revenues, but that deficit needs to be financed, and it's equivalent to the net debt, which is the end of the period debt minus the previous debt. So that deficit needs to find a space in the budget and needs to be financed in the markets, right? So let me start with an example. Let's assume that we have country A, and country A has a debt of 100. You could think it's $100 billion, right? And that is, and let's assume that that's a debt that as a percentage of GDP is too high. So what we need to do is to bring that debt as a percentage of GDP to a lower level through time, right? So that means that that country needs to start paying debt immediately, not necessarily, because debt over GDP is a ratio. So let me tell you the following example. If this country, the growth rate is 6%, that means that a debt could still grow by 5%, but just because it's growing less than the country, the debt over GDP growth is gonna reduce. So that's the way in which, coming from a debt sustainability exercise and a macro exercise, you could start calculating what should be the path of the debt, and also give you the intervals, which are the deficits that could be, that are gonna be fit in the budget, okay? So this is an example. We picked this example, it's a theoretical example, and it's a random example. And in this random example, the steady state, that the debt over GDP at which this country is okay, is 50%, right? So that's a horizontal line. And then you start from a high level, and you try to reduce it to time. What you have on the x-axis is time. And when you take two periods, that's what is going to give you the deficit for that year. So the principle to start having a sustainable fiscal path, start by understanding where is the debt path. So how do you actually do this in practice? How do you have discipline in a government? So I'm going to start with trying to figure out, because we very often talk about the ministries of finance in an abstract term, but the ministries of finance tend to have many actors working with different interests and different mandates within. So this is going to be the canonical Ministry of Finance. In a canonical Ministry of Finance structure, you have a deputy finance minister, which is typically in charge of the macro and the fiscal and the financial issues, the regulation of the financial markets. Then you tend to have a revenue vice minister, which is in charge of tax policy. So it's in charge of determining which are the taxes that are going to be collected, and a budget vice minister, which is the one who is in charge of the expenditure. Typically, you have other functions which are not necessarily policy oriented. So how is this organized? So the way in which a proper fiscal sustainability mechanism its structure is you start with the chief economist, which calculates the sustainable path, which I refer. Then the chief economist also calculate what are the macro projections. So that's typically how much is the country going to grow, what is going to be the interest rates, what is expected key variables like the interest rate on the US of the price of oil is going to be. And then the office of the chief economist send that information to the tax policy unit. Now, why is important that that information is coming from the chief economist? Because the tax policy unit, what they are going to do is estimate, they are going to forecast the tax revenues. And if you allow them to forecast that with their own variables, they are going to underestimate the revenues, because if they collect it more, they are going to look good. So you don't allow them to estimate it with whatever variables they want. You do the chief economist. And then you have the net debt, and then you have the revenues, and that is sent to the budget. So the people who decide expenses are gonna do the allocations, but not of what they want, but what the country has. And that's one way to make sure that you don't overspend more than the country has. So this is okay. We have this. This was originally a PowerPoint presentation, but I think they put it in an Acrobat presentation. So it was intended to be animated. So I'm missing a few things here. But the point is, the revenue side is equal to the left-hand side, and it has to be determined at the same time. Now, what is interesting is that you have this process. This has institutionalized process to make sure that the country is not going on an unsustainable path. Now, that's at the budget preparation, but that also has to be transferred to the revenue, to the process of approval. So let me give you two examples. I'm going to give you the example of Mexico and Colombia. Okay. So the first thing that in Mexico do is they estimate this increase on the debt, which is the deficit, right? Then estimate the taxes, and that give you all the sources of income that the country is going to have. It's sent to the parliament, and the parliament discuss this, and the parliament approve it, right? Once this is decided, the parliament could start deciding the budget side. Now, let me ask you a question. Which side of the public finances do you think that members in Congress are more interested? The budget side or the revenue side? The budget. They are interested in how much, which projects they are going to approve, if they could approve a project for their village, if they could do that, right? So in countries in which these things are discussed at the same time, typically people in the parliament want to increase the budget, and then they overestimate the revenues that are going to be collected. So a way to try to discipline them that is to try to make sure that they approve that revenue, and then they could find how they are going to allocate the budget side, but it cannot be more than the original envelope. In a country like Colombia and in Brazil, the parliament, the Congress actually discuss these two things at the same time. So they overestimate the budget, and then they have to overestimate the revenue side. And two things are going to happen after that. Either the country is going to have a debt that is higher than it's expected, or they are going to have a budget which is not functional, and they are going to have to ration it. So this is an example coming from this year in Mexico. This is actually the framework, the macroeconomic framework, and you will have variables like inflation, et cetera. And that's the base to start to understand these things. Okay, so now let me come up with another problem. So the change in the debt is the deficit, is what is gonna be a source of resources to pay. But it also means that you require a market to finance that deficit, right? So let me give you again the same example. You have a country that has country A, who has $100 billion in debt, and it has an authorization to go to $105 billion by the end of the year. That means that in net terms, this country has to increase or has an authorization to increase by $5 billion the debt, which will go on the expenditure side for the budget. But let's assume that this country has $20 billion of which are due during that year that has to be paid. So it starts with a debt of 100, it goes down to 80, but it has an authorization to go to 105. So they have to contract $25 billion. So that implies two things. On the fiscal side, we already discussed that. It has to be aligned with a fiscal sustainability path. But on the financial side, that means that there has to be some bank or some institution or the markets that are willing to lend them $25 billion. So there are two aspects about it: the budget side and the financial side. So let me give you an example about how this process could be broken down, right? So this is where a budget, the way in which a budget is approved. So this is approved by Congress, and these are the expenditures, these are the taxes. So the difference between the expenditures minus the taxes is the debt. This is just a definition. So once the Congress approved this, they approved the expenditures and they approved the taxes, they implicitly are approving the debt. Now, there are many countries in which the framework is not properly set in an institutional way. And there are many developing countries that need to work to have a proper institutional framework. But it's not only developing countries. Let me tell you what happened in the U.S. In the U.S., the Congress approved this. So let's assume that this is 300, then approve the revenues, and let's assume that this is 290. So even a child in elementary school knows that if they approve 300 here and 290 here, that means that they have approved 10 in net debt. But then the U.S. Congress actually required an additional discussion about what should be the debt. And that's what you're seeing in the U.S., where the Congress is actually hijacking the government in order to be able to approve the debt process. That's why the U.S., which is the richest country in the world, a few years ago have their credit rating downgraded by Standard & Poor's because of an institutional process. So this is are issues that matter for every country in the world, including for the richer countries. Now, we have at the bank a tool to try to assess how countries do it. It's called the Public Expenditure and Financial Accountability Program. And it has one specific component, which is about management of assets and liabilities. This is what you will see on this light color is what you will see for debt management across region. So the region that has the best debt management is Europe and Central Asia. You will find SAR over here, your region, and Africa over here on the other side of the spectrum. So let me finish with a few remarks. So what is required for fiscal sustainability? And the interesting thing is that for fiscal sustainability, you don't start to do the setup by this budget, to looking the medium and the term, and then you find what is the fiscal element for this. Second, requires strong macro and debt frameworks. It requires institutional arrangements of checks and balances so that those who forecast revenue cannot with their own information. It has to come from economists. Those who allocate the budget cannot allocate what they want, they are given. And by process like that, one, it creates credibility. Credibility translates and access to the financial markets. So the credibility that Japan has and to interest rates that are very low, despite the fact that they have a very high debt. Finally, quite consistently across, because problems of the 80s, problems are of the 80s are coming. This is what I'm seeing in countries, including South Asia.
Arturo, thank you. Very nice, very interesting. It's of course, procedures to keep the budget in check. And maybe democracy is a nuisance. We should stop playing democracy. That's what I keep, and I keep getting a push from my, that no, you can't speak against democracy. And rules-based order requires democracy, but the rules-based order is failing too. But what I missed in your presentation, or after this, there's no matter. For example, countries that are growing, I mean, India, for example, is not on your list. China was not on the list. These countries are growing rapidly. And therefore, plus they've got a huge amount of reserves. So they've got their debt situation in control. It reminds me of kind of something like Apple, for example, which had a huge amount of revenues. And it didn't want to bring its revenues onto the onshore because they have a huge tax liability. So they went out and borrowed a huge amount to be able to get over the tax liability and incur. It's an accounting exercise, but nevertheless, I think growth is the most important part. I remember a long time ago when I did a paper on debt sustainability with my favorite co-author, Peter Montiel, and we realized the most important variable was growth. That, simply put, it's the if the growth rate is higher, and this is the point that I think in a roundabout way, Piketty also makes, that R is greater than G, you're fine. I'd put it differently. If G is greater than R, you've got it made. So how would growth enter? That's one question. The second question is, why do these countries borrow so much? I mean, I'm all against Pakistan borrowing anymore. I've been against it for the last 20 years. Why does Pakistan borrow? I have no coherent reason to understand why Pakistan borrows. Neither does the government tell me why they borrow. They just tell us we borrow, and we have no coherent debt framework. But the debt keeps increasing. Every day we read in the newspapers, the debt increases. And we still see no reason. So tell me, what about growth? And why does debt increase? And what can we do to stop debt increasing?
Actually, a presentation starts with growth. If you remember the first example I do, it's a country that needs to start to reduce their debt, but it's a country which is growing at 6%. So it could increase the debt by 5% because then the debt is growing at a lower pay. Exactly. So it's there. So the debt sustainability exercise, that is the one the first I mentioned, the key component of the sustainability exercise is growth, right? So if you think about China, which is growing at more than 5% right now, if you think about Pakistan, which is growing at less than 1 or 2%. Well, so it's different what it could be achieved. So growth is the first is a first variable, but then the way in which you borrow, which bring me to your second question, matter, and assumptions matter. And when you borrow, you are taking a liability and you are taking a risk. And that risk needs to be managed properly. So let me tell you what happened with my country in the late 70s. So we discovered oil in Mexico, right? And it was hugely important. At some point, oil revenues were 8% of GDP. Just so that you have an idea, Pakistan tax collection is 10% of GDP. So at some point, just the revenue coming from oil in Mexico was almost as high as all the tax collection in Pakistan, right? So what is what people thought in Mexico? Okay, we have these new oil fields. Let's exploit them. So we need resources. We are going to borrow to do it, right? Now, the oil, so this is Mexico. We have our own currency, which is the peso, but the oil is not sell in pesos. It sell in dollars. So you say, okay, we go to the financial markets and we borrow in dollars and we sell in dollars. So that the risk is hedged in terms of a currency, and there was no problem, right? There was actually a president who said, the problem that we will have in the future is how to manage our wealth. We're going to be a rich country, and we don't know how to manage how to be a rich country, right? So you have these revenues coming from oil, and you have matched the currency risk. Everything is fine except that the debt was in a variable interest rate, was not a fixed rate. So everything was fine if the interest rates will not go up and the price of oil, which is in dollars, stay where it was. So nothing of that happened after 82. The price of oil went down, the interest rate went up, and basically the country has to default. So even something that is done with well intention and it looks like it's much, it has a risk. So it has to be prudent in terms of how much debt it can be high. A few years ago, during the COVID, I was the finance minister of Mexico, and the impact of COVID was brutal in Mexico. Brutal. The GDP reduced by more than 8%. That's the highest drop since 1934, since the Great Depression. And as you know, I don't know what was the case on Pakistan, but in many developed countries, the governments start acquiring debt to support the economy, right? They provide credits to the firms. They provide soft loans. They advanced economies have these automatic stabilizers, or like unemployment insurance, etc. So they were spending a lot and finance it through that. But Mexico cannot do it legally, because in Mexico, at the constitution, every single peso borrowed through that has to be invested in public works, in infrastructure. So you create a liability and you create an asset. And of course, in the middle of this very bad crisis, we thought, why is that, right? Why is it actually in the constitution? So I asked one of my advisors to go and check historical documents to try to find out when was this constitutional amendment established. And it was established in the 1940s. After the war, and basically the members of the Congress which write up this constitutional amendment, he find a phrase in which said, after the revolution in Mexico, and that was in 1910, from 1910 and 1920, the credibility of Mexico went down so badly that it took almost 30 years to recover it. So what they put in the constitution is, man, the country is not going to go through that road again. So from now on, if you borrow, it's only to build an asset. So countries deal with these issues in different ways. But coming back to your question, growth is the anchor for the macro framework. Growth is the macro for the stability. And yes, in many countries, borrowing actually allows countries to grow faster. But the lessons of the oil borrowing in Mexico in the late 70s, it's also an example of how one needs to be careful about
it. Thank you, Arturo. I have three questions, short ones. Well, the first one, when you mentioned your own country, Mexico. Now, it's interesting. I just want to know what NAFTA has actually done for Mexico and whether it had anything to do with perpetuating more growth and less with more revenues. I mean, I've read papers that say that NAFTA has worked well for Spain, Mexico, but I just want to, and the context is that what would open trade, or rather relatively open trade, bring to countries? For example, we have this debate in Pakistan. So I just want to know from your own experience, what would you suggest? What did NAFTA do in case of what you're trying to, what you've presented over here? Second, you presented the case of Japan. So we know that Japan has been in a liquidity trap since the 90s, at least the mid 90s. So when you talk about the debt to GDP ratio over there and that being sustainable and Japan having no problems, I just want to know whether your framework or what you are saying takes into account the differences. For example, the demographic profile of Japan is very different from maybe Mexico or Pakistan. Does that take into account those factors? And the third one is, as far as Pakistan is concerned, and again it comes back to the framework that you presented for sustainable debt management. So we do have laws, like we have FRDL, and that limits how much the public debt can grow as a percentage of GDP. We do have different institutions, like within finance division, you'll have one, we do have debt management unit. But it's all about implementation. Pakistan has laws aplenty. But how do you go about ensuring that somebody, or what is your experience, is that how do we manage that, or how do we enforce that thing? What's the best way of doing that? Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. So these are very, very interesting questions. And the first one about free trade, it's a tricky one. And let me tell you why. Free trade for Mexico has been extremely important, right? First of all, we have a 2,000 kilometer border with the US. It's impossible to think that there's another way to do it. If you think of a large cities in that border, like Ciudad Juarez or Tijuana, Tijuana is just across San Diego, right? And if you want to go not to the east, but to the south, probably the next largest city will be 1,000 kilometers further south, right? So if in terms of being able to trade, it is with San Diego, which is just 2 meters from the border, right? But free trade does not solve all the problems, right? So it was incredibly helpful. But for a country like Mexico, which is a high middle income country, we have only less than 30% of the population having a banking account. So that means that you have a financial sector that is very shallow, and therefore how to transfer savings to investment is very problematic. I don't know what are the numbers in Pakistan, but for a country that is very open in many ways, Mexico has one of the lowest female participation rates in Latin America. Only 47% of the women above 15 years old participate in the labor force. That's incredibly low, even if you think that it's much lower than Chile, much lower than Uruguay, lower than Brazil, which are typically the countries we compare, but it's lower than Bolivia, which is less developed than Mexico, and it's actually slightly lower than El Salvador. So that will bring us, if you think in a production function, to the human capital or the labor or the labor factor. You have labor and labor factor, which is not used, and you have a financial factor, which is not used. So despite the fact that Mexico has NAFTA, it has had traditionally since the 80s, one of the lowest growth rates in Latin America. Now, that very low growth rate is actually 2%, which is around what Pakistan is, and we are very ashamed in Mexico having that growth rate. We have actually a population which in Mexico is growing over that period at around 1% per year. So that means that we still have a very low but positive GDP per capita growth. In Pakistan, my sense is that you are growing, the population grows more than 2%, which means that the GDP per capita is actually going down. That's extremely troublesome. So free trade, it could be one component, but it's just one of many components that has to be taken. The other problem is the low taxation rate, which in Mexico, the low taxation capacity in Mexico is 14% of GDP. It's actually higher than Pakistan. But let me give you an example, which I thought is gonna, it could be very interesting. If you think about around probably 12 years, which is not much, the tax collection in Mexico was probably about 10 to 11% of GDP, pretty much where Pakistan is right now. But we were having 8% of revenues coming from oil. So that means that all revenues were around 18% of GDP. It was not sufficient. And then we were borrowing 2% of GDP, 2-3% for a total budget envelope of around 22 to 23% of GDP. Pakistan has around that 20% of GDP, but they don't have the oil that we have. So what are you doing? That's the deficit you are incurring. And that's opposed to oil, you have to pay it back. So yes, the issue of demographics, which I start mentioning, is critical. The population of Japan is actually going up and present some other challenges. One of the ways in which we measure success in a society is by the life expectancy of a society. So when a society is much rich, population tend to live longer. But that means also that you may have huge pension challenges. And those are things that we are starting to deal. And actually the thing that I skip, and I'm sorry, my presentation was supposed to be on PowerPoint and to be animated, and then I realized it was fixed. But the institutional part about the budget, which is critical, it has three parts. It's the budget preparation. So in the budget preparation, you start macro and debt sustainability, that becomes the revenue, all sources of income, and that becomes the budget envelope. Now, that same logic, you take it to the Congress. You approve first the revenue side, and then you discuss the budget side. But the same logic, and I skip that part, is you take it to the management of the budget, right? So what happened through the year? Imagine a country like Mexico where oil is still important, not as important in the past. And then you have, let's say, a reduction of the price of oil from 80 to 40, right? Your revenues are going to increase. So the chief economist start triggering that. And he said, my macro framework changed. So goes to the tax policy group and said, you have to reformulate through the year what is the impact on the revenue forecast. And then they go back to the budget expenditure and say, you have to reduce it to this amount. So the budget expenditure cannot decide to keep it up or down. It's the other areas of the Ministry of Finance which send them. So the institutional part of it is the different check and balances that operate. It has to be operated at the budget preparation, which is probably what is happening in Pakistan. It has to be operated at a political level, so you don't allow the Congress to go beyond certain, and it has to be operated at a management level. So if things, it could also happen that the price of oil goes up, right? And then they check it, they go to revenue, we have more money, and then they turn to the budget and say, actually, you have more space to allocate. That happened to in the 2000s, right? Oil start at 20, then 30, 40, 50, and 80. The problem in the 2000s was where to spend the money. But this is not what is happening. You may remember during COVID, you have the breakout of COVID in December in China. Then in the week of January 23rd, you have the first cases in advanced economies and a full-fledged infection through March. So and a huge lockdown down. So the ports were stopped and the economic activity went down. So the price of oil plummeted. Now think about the oil that was prepared to be already exported. It was in ships that were going nowhere. For a few days in the history, in the modern economic history, the price of oil was actually negative because it was costing for firms to actually have it in ships. So they were paying if you want to take it out of their hands. So now come back to the budget and think, okay, I have a price of oil, which is 60, but now it's zero. So you have to adjust on the revenue side, and then you have to adjust on the budget side. So the three pieces are needed.
Mehtab, Adar Sahab, sir, please unmute yourself, sir.
Gee, thank you very much, Dr. Sahab. Sir, I have two questions. My name is Mehtab Haider. I work for the News. I'm a journalist. Sir, my first question is, do you think that keeping in view the overall fiscal situation of Pakistan, our tax to GDP ratio is close to 10%? And it's mainly because if you analyze the revenues of the current financial year, there's a low GDP growth, but inflation is on higher side. So the nominal growth is actually helping Pakistan to jack up its revenues. And on the other side, the indirect taxes are too much high. If you include withholding taxes as indirect taxes, it's around 80% are indirect taxes and only 20% are direct taxes. So my question is, keeping in view that this fragmentation between the center and the provinces, while the World Bank suggests that should it be a national tax agency, or in Pakistan there is a debate that FBR should also be divided into two parts. So what is the experience globally? And keeping in view your presentation on debt, in Pakistan there is a Fiscal Responsibility and Debt Limitation Act, but since its inception, it was breached every year. But our parliament is so much, people are sitting there, that they never bothered to discuss it in details, and it was never implemented, and it was never penalized by anyone, that why it was violated and our debt to GDP ratio is increasing. Except now it decreased because of rebasing. We did the rebasing of GDP and it helped to show the some reduction. But in absolute number, it's increasing. So what is the way forward, keeping in view the international experience? Thank you very much.
Should I? Yeah. Okay. So I think, what's his name? Mehtab make very interesting points, because if you have only 10% of tax collection, right, and you have a debt of 77% of GDP, how are you going to pay the debt? And the one particular way in which you are paying the debt is through inflation, right? If you have an inflation of 22% of GDP, other things equal, the real value of the debt is going to be reduced at 20%. So who's paying the debt? All of you are paying the debt, because you're by paying higher prices on goods and services, that's the way in which debt is due. And that's typical of many countries which have a fiscal structure which is not necessarily sustainable. It actually has a name. It's called the inflationary tax of seigniorage, right? So there's nothing new about it. So let me just mention three quick questions. He referred to the to the legal constraint on debt, but it is not being fulfilled. It has to have some institutional arrangement like the one that I mentioned. It's not the only one, but it has to be anchored institutionally. Laws that are not easy to implement are not operationally relevant. Then the issue of indirect taxes versus direct taxes is critical for many countries, But indirect taxes tend to be still very relevant when you have high informal sector. And I presume that the informal sector in Pakistan is more than 50%. Now let me touch the final two issues. The one about the connection with the national agencies and the provinces. And think about federal governments, right? Pakistan is one, federal nations. The US another one. Russia is another one. Mexico is another one. Brazil is another one. What's common in all of them? I mentioned some in Latin America.
Federation.
Yeah, but why are all of them federations? Because they are huge. With the exception of countries like Switzerland, where there are federations because they have different cultures and languages, most of the federal countries tend to be large countries like Pakistan. Actually, your provinces have more than 50 million people, right? Colombia, a very important country in the world, has less than 50 million people, right? So when you have a federal arrangement, typically you need to allow the provinces to have some sort of autonomy, otherwise it's very complicated to manage. Anybody knows how many people live in Dominica? Not in Dominican Republic. In Dominica, it's a country, small island in the Caribbean, 40,000 people, right? Probably twice the number of students in this university. You don't need to have a federal system in Dominica, right? But you need to have a federal system in Pakistan and requires to have some sort of autonomy. But finally, let me go to an issue which I think is really important, which is the low tax collection rate. And the tax collection rates vary across the world. Let me ask you a question. Do you know which are the two countries with the largest tax over GDP ratios? Denmark is one of them. And the other one is France. And let me why. It's around 43% of GDP. So you could collect a lot of, and the US, it's in the 20s, right? So in general, advanced economies collect more than developing countries. But you could still find difference between a country like the US and France and Denmark. And what happened in France and Denmark is that you collect a lot of taxes, but you provide a lot of services. Health is basically free, and education is free from kindergarten to university. So what is behind this is kind of the social contract that a country has, is the citizens are willing to pay certain amount in exchange of certain services. And in a country of the US, they will say, no, we don't pay that much. We keep our proceeds if we get rich, but some people are going to be much poorer than in Denmark. You allow inequality. And the issue of the social contract and trust is key when countries are trying to decide if they should be collecting more. And that requires a collective agreement across different sectors of a population.
Please go ahead.
My name is Shaukat Randhawa. I retired as Joint Economic Advisor to the Government of Pakistan. I've been with Planning Commission for decades. So my question is very strange. Dr. Nadimullah just said that he is surprised that why do we borrow? So my question is, do we need to borrow or are we made to borrow? I mean, most of us must have gone through those confessions of the economic hitman. I'm not referring to it. But I've been dealing with, you just showed in your, I think, third slide, the components of expenditure. It was recurrent expenditure, capital expenditure, and debt. So we call it development expenditure. And when we come to development expenditure, it's a very cherished subject of and forte of Dr. Nadimul Haq. We have been having sessions on it. It's quite a major chunk of our budget, the development expenditure. We borrow for those projects. And how those projects are made, how those projects are conceived, we have got reservations of that. We know about that. There are individual whims. There are particular expedients. And I am talking of those projects, those programs, which are rather, I won't say that they're thrown upon us. They're suggested by international organizations and reputed. For those projects, we borrow. Most of the projects don't deliver the anticipated and envisaged objectives. So my question is that why we need to borrow to that extent? And that's my first question. The second reference, which you were discussing with Shah Sahib, it was just a digression towards international trade. Incidentally, I was part of that team which prepared for the Doha agenda. The multilateral trade is dwindling these days, and even the WTO is worried about that. So why so that the Doha agenda, which was conceived in 2001, has not been ended to this date? What is the problem? Thank you.
So let me first go to your first question, which is about what to borrow for. And it may be that there are problems of implementing the projects that you are borrowing, and there are questions about their actual impacts. But my question to you is, does that happen also with resources invested in projects which are not coming from lending? So I suspect it is, right? So now, nowadays, the bank moved to impact, to impact way to manage things a long time ago. We don't want to spend just for spend. We want to make sure that it has impacts. But we also recognize that takes time to become ingrained and to be part of the institutionality. After a project which is supposed to have an impact is concluded, it has to have an audit. A few months ago, I was having a chat with the head of the Supreme Audit Institution in the US, right? 90% of all the audits that they do are performance audit, impact audits, right? But they start doing that in 1970s. So it took a long time. So that's why I concluded that with an slide that mentioned that it requires consistency, because some of these things takes time. Takes time to do it. What was the second question? I'm sorry. Oh yeah, I mean, everything that was the world after COVID is different than the world that we live today, right? Actually, if you go 1 year before COVID, we have trade tensions between the US and China. Then you have COVID. Then you have inflation, and that's a legacy of COVID. Then you have the invasion of Ukraine. After you have the invasion of Ukraine, you have the price of grains going up, interest rates going up, and then we have geopolitical tensions everywhere. We have coups in the Sahel. We have Gaza. We have Ukraine. So the way that we conceive the world until 2019 is very different than the world that we are facing now. On top of that, we are seeing new trends or challenges that were present and that we need to tackle, like climate change. Everybody was aware, but it was an issue that we were postponing. So the challenges that we are facing and the urgency of them are completely different. Now, the trade that we had until COVID was based on the idea that the transport costs went down. I'm gonna suggest you to check a podcast. It's a very interesting podcast. It's called Planet Money in the US. It's a podcast about economic issues. It's for everybody. But they did one very interesting experiment around 12, 13 years ago, which is they were trying to figure out how a T-shirt that was sold in the US was actually produced, right? And they so in order to do it, they actually produce a T-shirt that said Planet Money here, right? And it started either with cotton in the US, then it was sent to Thailand, then it was sent to several countries. I think the Planet Money was printed in Colombia, and it was sent back to the US, right? And the key for all that to happen is low transport costs, right? In a world of very low transport costs, you could be producing a T-shirt going through many countries. And before COVID, many of those stops were in China, right? So what people think now is there's no problem in having a big part of your value chain in one country unless something happens and this country closes. And that's what happened during COVID, and China closed, and that disrupted the value chain. So now people say, okay, we better have it either closed or have it in less than all these countries, because if something happened again, we don't want to face that risk. So yes, the world that we face now is different than the pre COVID, and everything is being reevaluated for reasons like this one, but also for geopolitical reasons that are different than 2019.
Steve, go ahead.
And thank you for excellent presentation. I'm Nasser from Python. I was just trying to connect your three slides. First is the regular reversal or regular frequency of the crisis. So you mentioned rightly. So it's look like a natural phenomena. Then the second table where you're trying to show the debt to GDP ratio, it's somewhere it's like 200 plus, somewhere it's 30%. And the third slide where you can give us some sort of mathematical equation to solve this sustainability issue. So my question is that while connecting these three slides, it gives an impression that this mathematical exercise of this whole fiscal sustainability framework is look like an irrelevant phenomena, because that with this mathematical exercise, you can't solve the entire problem. It also gives like to some extent the answer or the question that the raised by other people. Look, we have the FRDL, Fiscal Sustainable Responsibility and Debt Limitation Act, but the lack of implementation or lack of execution would undermine the entire phenomena of this fiscal sustainability. And the last observation, if we look into the last 20 years budget of government of Pakistan, where they try to give like, this is the proposed budget, and then the end of the year, they give the actual figures. You can find a trend that there is always like a deviation from the actual and what they actually propose. So with all these elements, one of the PIDE study also mentioned that the relevance would come from the environment that actually matter in terms of policy, but we call it a policy environment. Maybe Dr. Deem has said, maybe it could be an institutional environment. How you see all these type of exercise would work? And if they are not working, what would be the second best solution?
So it seems I should have gone deeper on some of these issues, because the institutionality is very relevant. It's what make it work. And think, for example, of someone, and it's a check and balances, but it's also something I didn't mention, which is the accountability. So think about someone on the budget side, which may want to give a budget expansion, right? Under this accountability mechanism, institutional mechanism, only could do it if someone on the revenue side communicate to that person that they're expected to have additional revenues. If they do it without that, it actually will be illegal and it will have personal administrative responsibilities for that. So it has to be, the whole loop has to be closed in terms of budget preparation, budget approval, budget execution, and accountability mechanism.
Go ahead.
Mr. Arthur, I'm Saddam. I work at PIDE. My question is to you that why are we ignoring the elephant in the room, the excessive regulation? It comes from the Hernando de Soto, the Portuguese economist. He wrote about it. He gave the example of Egypt and Portugal and I guess Mexico as well, that it took years and years to get approvals for some economic activity, just for opening a shop, for example. And this suffocates the economy and then people operate in extra legal domain. So when they operate in extra legal domain, they cannot get to the economic potential what they have because they are operating extra legally. So means lesser transactions, lesser economic transaction. And that means it also impacts the taxes and the revenues. So that translates into the fiscal equations of the country. So why IFIs keep a mum about a regulation issue? I guess the biggest issue at the time on the screen. So what is your view on that? Can it really have that much impact as we at PIDE advocate?
And actually the bank for a long time was producing this indicator, which now is going to be produced again under a different name. Now it's going to be business ready. In the past was called doing business. And it tried to and one of the dimensions of that study is to just to document how long does it take to open a business. Again, in some of the European countries, it could take a couple of days. In some developing countries, it could take 300 days. And what people like you and what people in the government should do, and what people actually at the World Bank should do, and I always remind this to my team is, why are we doing something? What is the problem that we are trying to understand? And what is the problem that we are trying to solve? And that's also a valid question for regulations. Why do we have this regulation? And then try to streamline from there.
Thank you for a wonderful discussion. Before I get to my question, I think you love reading PIDE's large audit, which actually talks about the difficulties that businesses face in opening different getting their operations done and getting all the permissions. We have done two volumes of that. Dr. Ahmed Vakar, he led that work under Dr. Nadeem's supervision. So basically what we find out in that is that just a handful of economic activities have about 45% of GDP as a regulatory sludge that they're facing due to excessive regulations. Now coming to the question that I had in my mind after your presentation, I think there was a lot of discussion around tax to GDP ratio and debt to GDP ratio. But I think one thing that was lacking and something that's lacking, not just from the discourse at the World Bank, but also with what the IMF proposes a lot and it misses in its discourse and discussions, is the investment to GDP ratio, which again, we believe is linked a lot with the country's regulatory environment as well. And in Pakistan, we have a significantly low investment to GDP ratio. And even the growth booms that we have, you know, periodically, they are a lot dependent on consumption-based, you know, growths, right? So why is that missing from the discourse at the World Bank, at other international institutions, and why that isn't focused on, especially for developing countries and countries in crisis like Pakistan?
So let me actually first come to this to the issue of the audits or regulation. Today is 24, 23? 25th. Okay, I'll spend the last 2 days traveling. But if you go and check the world, I presume if you go and check the World Bank website, you will find a chat. I miss it because I was flying. A chat between one of our managing directors, Anna Birde, and Kat Sunstein, a top behavioral economist. And two of his recent books, and I actually, we invite him for several meetings on my team. One is actually called Sludge. That's the title of that. Yeah, okay, so you will see it. He was at the back.
He's been speaking to us a lot.
Yeah, so and the other one is called Simpler, which is about eliminating regulation. I think he's pretty much on top of these things. Now, actually, I would say the majority of the things that the World Bank do is about investment. Most of our projects are investment in infrastructure, right? Now, you have to do it in a way that you don't run excessive risk, like the example I gave you about Mexico in the 70s. But then also you have to ask yourself why you don't have sufficient investment. And let me give you again the example I made in Mexico. If you have a very shallow financial sector, you won't have investment, right? So the national institutes in Mexico ask firms by size if they have access to finance. 100% of all the largest firms that they have access to finance. Only 10% of the small firms say they have access to finance. So if a small firm wants to invest, they basically have to retain earnings, and the investment is gonna be much smaller. So simplification is one of it, but a dynamic financial sector is relevant, and that is the banking sector plus the capital markets. Now, who's the banking sector lending in Pakistan? It's fundamentally lending to the government. So if you don't solve the fiscal size of Pakistan, you won't have banking resources to lend to the private sector, and therefore they will be investing whatever their return earnings are gonna allow. So all these issues are connected.
Dr. Arshad Mahmood Malik, sir, please go ahead and ask your question.
Thank you very much. Very good presentation. And my question is, basically, I'm Arshad from Agriculture University, Rawalpindi. I just want to need to, it's an extension of previous questions, that whether only tax, public debt to GDP ratio is important, or if we see the debt to foreign reserve ratio, even if, as per your slide, the Mexico case, the debt to foreign reserve ratio is only 3%. And in case of Japan, it is about less than 8%. But in case of Pakistan, if we see, it is more than 17%. So, I just want to get insight from your experience that how the country has to focus on which important sector, either as per previous question, investment or foreign reserve ratio or the tax GDP. Thank you.
Yeah. No, I mean, I'm going to be a very simple question for anybody, and that's individual persons. The amount that could borrow, it depends on the capacity to repay it, right? So if I borrow $15 million from a bank, I'm going to go bankrupt in a month, right? Now, if Bill Gates borrowed $15 million from a bank, I'm sure that he could pay it in a couple of days, right? And for a country, the GDP is just a proxy for the income, because the revenue is coming from the taxes, and that's the base that is going to be taxable. It's just an approximation to that. But as I mentioned it before, it depends also of how strong the how strong the country is, and therefore how willing are the markets to lend them basing their strength. And that willingness translates along with the stability in low interest rates. So let me tell you the second part of my story that I mentioned it, because this dysfunctional way in which the U.S. approves the debt part, actually the U.S. credit rating was downgraded. That was probably 10 years ago by Standard & Poor's, which was something unbelievable at that time. Now, could you imagine what happened if Pakistan is downgraded? The cost of borrowing is going to increase at the moment this is announced, right? Now, when Standard & Poor's announced that the U.S. was going to be downgraded, the financial sector took that as a signal that it was something potentially so bad that even the U.S. was downgraded. And when you have that kind of uncertainty, you actually go to the currency which is safer, which is the dollar. So actually, the opposite happening. They start buying dollars, and the interest rate and the dollar was revaluated. So that happened with the U.S., may happen with some advanced economies. That's important why to have this idea of having robust finances, which developing countries tend to be much weaker at. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry we've run out of time, it seems. I think we've had a wonderful session. All I would say is that I think, quite frankly, the thing that we need to worry about in Pakistan and developing countries that we don't, unfortunately, is that we really do not, these are artificially created states. These states do not exist. And these states were created by fiat by the colonial government, and we are still continuing on that. On that, we build up a whole superstructure. And we think this is a normal state. It's not a normal state. So in our reform agenda, we talk about that, first of all, we have to really begin to understand the country. And we have to begin to understand what you talk about, chief economist, is that we don't have the capacity. We don't have those people who can do it. Every time we train somebody, he goes to the World Bank. So what do we do? Got a huge brain drain issue that we have to talk about. And we should think about it, that how do we build capacity? But capacity doesn't get built by World Bank doing a project. We've had about maybe 100,000 projects of capacity building. I used to be in the fund, and I used to do a lot of this through the, when I was in the IMF Institute, do a lot of training. It's useless. I used to say, look, guys, we need to have a big conference. Tobias, maybe you should do it with us. We need to have two big conferences, one on capacity building, the other on technical assistance. What role do these two play? Do they build domestic capacity or not? So we, in our reform agenda, we talk about building capacity, one, and also building institutions. We don't have institutions. We have the institution that we inherited from the colonials. Then within that, we've got to discuss what is the role of the government. I don't think we've ever discussed it. We wrote a paper, Peter and I, a long time ago on the role of the government. Unfortunately, I lost it. We published it in Mexico because we got some money for it. But the bloody thing, I've lost it. It's only in Spanish, so I can't translate it myself. So I think the role of the government is very important. What is the role of the government? And we keep expanding the role of the government wherever we can. So there's always a hunger for the budget. And then we say match the taxation. I think that's an unending debate, unending proposition for us. We can't match the expenditures with the revenues that we want. If we want to match the expenditures with the revenues, because the expenditure is always growing, because sometimes we got this need, for example, a flood comes, we build another agency, something else happens, we build another agency. IFC comes along, says build a Fannie Mae, we build a Fannie Mae. We actually build a Fannie Mae, you know that, it's amazing. We build a commodity exchange that does nothing but trades in gold. So I mean, we got these crazy institutions, which we pay for. Got a huge public sector. We got 5 million employees in the public sector, and we pay for them. And we give them a pension for their lifetime. We give them a pension for their daughter's lifetime. So, I mean, this is unsustainable. But how can we fix this if we don't have a reform? Second thing, we don't have any market in this country. We calculate the footprint of the government is about 80% of GDP. And we have no markets in this country. For example, the government buys wheat, the government buys sugar, the government constructs things, the government does this, the government does that. So we are half socialist, half this. On top of that, we've got Islam. So we got a whole confused thing. But where do we debate this? We don't debate it. We always focus on the taxation thing. So we are trying to raise the debate, guys. We need to get serious about developing our own economy from the grassroots. We can't keep fixing taxation and budget on that. But let's see. Let's hope we'll have success on that. It's a short prelude to what we are trying to do. But it's been wonderful to have you here. And we should continue this debate. Thank you very much, Arturo,
for the invitation.
Thank you.